Hello and welcome to worship service for today. This is service for the sixth Sunday after Pentecost, which is proper nine. This is the Mass for July 4th. However, because we are Episcopalian in nature, we will not be doing anything patriotic or July 4th related. Our opening hymn this morning is hymn number 535. We will do verses 1 and 4. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen.
Look, we are your friends. for some time while Saul was king over us, it was you who led out Israel and brought it in. The Lord said to you, it is you who shall be shepherd of my people Israel. You shall be ruler over Israel. So all the elders of Israel came to the king at Hebron, and David made a covenant with them at Hebron before the Lord, and they anointed David king over Israel. David was 30 years old when he began to reign, and he reigned 40 years. At Hebron he reigned over Judah 7 years and 6 months, and at Jerusalem he reigned over all Israel and Judah 33 years. David occupied the stronghold and named it the City of David. David built the city around the Millo and inward, and David became greater and greater the Lord God of hosts was with him. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. I will do some. I'll read and then you read. I'll read the first verse, so forth and so on. Okay? Great is the Lord, and highly to be praised in the city of our God and his holy hill.
Beautiful and lofty, the joy of all the earth is the hill on Zion, the very center of the world and the city of the great king.
God is a sinner. He is known to be a few perfect.
Behold, the kings of the earth are assembled and march forward together.
They looked and were astonished. They retreated and fled in terror.
Trembling seized them there. They writhed like a woman in childbirth, like ships of the sea when the east wind shatters them.
As we have heard, so have we seen, and the city of the Lord of hosts, and the city of our God, God has established earth forever.
We have waited in silence on your loving kindness, O God, in the midst of your temple.
Praise like your name, O God, reaches to the world's end. Your right hand is full of justice.
Let Mount Zion be glad and the cities of Judah rejoice because of your judgments.
Make the circuit of Zion, walk around about her, count the number of her towers.
Consider well her bulwarks, examine her strongholds, that you may tell those who come after.
This is God. This God is our God forever and ever. He shall be our guide forevermore. Praise be to God.
Reading from the second letter of Paul to the Corinthians. I know a person in Christ who 14 years ago was caught up to the third heaven. Whether in the body or out of the body, I do not know. God knows. And I know that such a person, whether in the body or out of the body, I do not know. God knows, was caught up into paradise and heard things that are not to be told, that no mortal is permitted to repeat. On behalf of such a one, I will boast, but on my own behalf, I will not boast, except of my weaknesses. But if I wish to boast, I will not be a fool, for I will be speaking the truth. But I refrain from it, so that no one may think better of me than what is seen in me or heard from me, even considering the exceptional character of the revelations. Therefore, to keep me from being too elated, a thorn was given me in the flesh, a messenger of Satan to torment me, to keep me from being too elated. 3 times I appealed to the Lord about this, that it would leave me. But he said to me, "My grace is sufficient for you, for power is made perfect in weakness. So I will boast all the more gladly of my weaknesses, so that the power of Christ may dwell in me. Therefore, I am content with weaknesses, insults, hardships, persecutions, and calamities for the sake of Christ. For whenever I am weak, then I am strong." Hear what the word is, hear what the Lord is saying to God's people.
Thank you, God.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to St. Mark.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Jesus came to his hometown and his disciples followed him. On the Sabbath he began to teach in the synagogue, and many who heard him were astounded. They said, "Where did this man get all of this? What is this wisdom that has been given to him? What deeds of power are being done by his hands? Is not this the carpenter, the son of Mary, the brother of James and Joseph and Judas and Simon, and are not all his sisters here with us?" And they took offense at him. Then Jesus said to them, "Prophets are not without honor except in their hometown and among their kin and in their own house." And he could do no deed of power there except that he laid his hands on a few sick people and cured them. And he was amazed at their unbelief. Then he went about among villages teaching. He called the 12 and began to send them out 2 by 2, and gave them authority over unclean spirits. He ordered them to take nothing with them for their journey except a staff, no bread, no bag, no money in their belts, but to wear sandals and not to put on 2 tunics. He said to them, "Whenever you enter a house, stay there until you leave the place. If any place will not welcome you and they refuse to hear you as you leave, shake off the dust that is on your feet as a testimony against them." So they went out and proclaimed that all should repent, and they cast out many demons and anointed with oil many who were sick and cured them. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise you, Lord Christ.
My friends, I speak to you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Please be seated. We are about halfway through our weeks-long journey through the beginning of Jesus' ministry as told to us through the Gospel of Mark. You'll remember that we're smack dab in the middle of year B, which the little subtitle would be the year of Mark. However, Mark is the shortest of the Gospels. Mark is the most succinct of the Gospels. He was also the first one to write down his trajectory of Jesus' life. You'll read in commentary after commentary that Matthew and Luke both used Mark's gospel and other stories that they knew or had heard about the risen Lord to create their gospels. So Mark tells it like it is. There was a TV show, I believe it was Dragnet, where the detective would say, "Just the facts, ma'am, just the facts." Well, that's Mark. He's our just the facts, ma'am. So when we find these two stories in our gospel from today that are squunched right together, that seem to have no relationship, we should take a moment to think about it before we dismiss them as two different entrees, shall we say, instead of a surf and turf combo. So the first story we hear is about Jesus going back to his hometown. Now, I'm not sure if any of you have had an experience similar, recently. The Wednesday that I was away a couple of weeks ago was to return, in fact, to my hometown for the first time as a priest to attend the ordination to the diaconate of a very dear friend. In fact, this ordination took place in the same church where I was baptized and confirmed and ordained to the transitional diaconate. And many of the faces were the same, many of the ushers and the readers, many of the priests who still live in the area. In fact, I remember very fondly one of the priests, Reverend Heath, who used to bless my stuffed animal when I was a child at the communion rail. That same stuffed dog is in my office in a red chasuble. You can see after Mass if you'd like. And when I went up to speak to several of these individuals, now remember I was wearing black shirt, collar, long black robes with my surplice over, and a beretta and a red stole, if I'm being honest, looking very priestly. Each one of these individuals looked at me and said, "Hi, my name is, welcome to Trinity Cathedral." And I thought, wow, I've known you 36 years. You have no idea who I am. I said, "I'm Jen Pilot." And they said, and then, of course, there we went. "I thought you were teaching Spanish. I thought you were refereeing rugby. I thought you were teaching at the university." "No, I'll give you three guesses." And I wasn't taken offense to, as Jesus was in his hometown, but you could very easily take the scriptures that these folks, upon seeing Jesus, said, "Isn't that the carpenter? Isn't that the kid who should have gone into the family business?" Because culturally, at the time that Jesus is alive, your father is a carpenter, you're a carpenter's son, and you will one day be a carpenter. Your first toys would have been a hammer and a block, and you would have trained and done apprenticeships alongside your father. Very easily, I could see these folks going, "Aren't you Anne's daughter? Aren't you supposed to be a Spanish teacher? A deacon, maybe, not a priest. What are you doing?" And that was a weird feeling. Having felt those feelings recently and thinking what it is that Jesus might be telling us today, I read the second half of this gospel. Jesus experiences all of these weird feelings as he is finally starting to come into his own in ministry, and the people don't accept him as a prophet. He turns to his disciples and he says, "You will not get respect in your hometown, among your families, and among the people who are in your own home." He says it in a generic fashion, but you can see him looking around and making eye contact with these apostles that he's about to send out into the world. And he pairs them up with no rucksack, no bag, no cell phone to call DoorDash when they get hungry, nothing. He sends them out with a staff so that they can walk. And he tells them, "This is your mission. This is the power of God that you have been entrusted with." Now, when we compare the deeds of power that Jesus was able to do in his hometown as the people doubted him and questioned him and questioned their faith in God, it tells us that he was not able to do a single deed of power except for curing a few people. Now, when we look at the disciples, once they have gotten faith in themselves and have gone out into the world armed with the power of God, the text tells us that they cast out many demons, anointed many who were sick, and cured them. Remember who's writing to us, though. It's Mark. Those extra words, "many demons, many who were sick," those extra words aren't something that Mark would include unless it mattered. Just the facts, ma'am. So Mark is telling us about that dichotomy between Jesus in his hometown, Jesus, the fully divine incarnate word on earth, was completely unable to do his deeds of power because of everyone else's unbelief. And then these 12, albeit they ordinary guys, fishermen, most of them, and a tax collector, not your scholars and prophets, just folks who believed in Jesus, were able to cast out many demons and cure many sick folks. That, my friends, is our lesson for today. It's not the power that we have in ourselves. It's the power that's bestowed on us by God to walk in the footsteps of Jesus, to realize the reality that surrounds us. You will not be respected in your hometown, and that's okay. There's plenty of work to be done outside of your hometown. Finally, the portion of Corinthians, 2 Corinthians that we read today from Paul, I want to call your attention to the very last sentence, the last three lines if you're following along. Therefore, I am content with weaknesses, insults, hardships, persecutions, and calamities for the sake of Christ. Now, y'all know more than anyone that Paul is not my best friend, that I very, very rarely preach from the epistle, especially if it's Paul, but I really think he's on to something here. It's very easy to be content with our strengths, to do the things that we know we're going to be successful with. But that's not what Jesus calls us to do. He calls us to examine our weakness, to share that, and to give it up to God. These insults, hardships, persecutions, and calamities are very reminiscent of the past 15 or 16 months, I do believe. And yet, boasting in the strength through weakness that Christ gives us is how we move forward and how we see what it is that we are called to do. Amen.
Amen.
Our service today continues with a proclamation of our faith, which is the Nicene Creed. Can be found on the front side of the bulletin about halfway down. We believe in one God, the Father the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us is our salvation. He came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. At this time, I'd like to open the floor for those who might have a prayer request. You, of course, can pray to God anytime, but if you'd like to pray aloud at this time, you're more than welcome to.
Peter.
Paul was still suffering from COVID.
For those who have died, most especially George and Joyce and my dear friend Frank.
And those who have died in the building collapse in Florida. For their families.
pray for the wisdom of doctors, nurses, and scientists in particular. Lord Jesus Christ, you said to your apostles, "Peace I give to you, my own peace I leave with you. Regard not our sins, but the faith of your church, and give us the peace and unity of that heavenly city, where with the Father and the Holy Spirit you live and reign now and forever. Amen.
Amen.
Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done, and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of our Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen.
Amen.
My friends, the peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Let us greet one another with a sign of the peace.
What is the sign of the peace?
Ever changing according to the CDC. Peace, peace.
Peace, peace.
Peace be with you.
At this time, I don't have any earth-shattering announcements. I do want to draw your attention to the fact that we will be having our next semi-annual Seabury Memorial Service to honor those who have passed away since probably mid-January until the present. This is an offering to the community for a way to deal with our grief. I think we're all kind of grief upon grief compounding. And so having a virtual offering to celebrate these lives, to acknowledge our own grief, and to move forward as a community is very important. The date that the service will air on the in-house television network is July 17th at 2 p.m. There will be an email. It will also be a YouTube link, so if you are not in front of a Seabury television at that time, you can watch it on your computer at any time. There are two Wednesdays in August between the 8th and the 20th where I will be in Newport, Rhode Island at a chaplain's course for the Navy, but it's on interfaith chaplaincy, so it will be relevant to the work here. So we will cancel those services in person, but I will be able to air videos from Newport. I've already checked with the instructors to make sure that I can still do that. And finally, perhaps we should have asked for this in our prayers, but my oldest child, Matthew, was able to get his driver's permit. So if you are in South Windsor, please put on your seatbelt, because we have a student driver, and he's now realizing that a car and a go-kart are very different. So may the force be with me and with my spirit. So thank you so much for being here today and for your patience. Offer to God a sacrifice of thanksgiving and make your vows to the Most High. Service of Holy Eucharist continues on the back of your bulletin. We will sing our Sanctus today, so you might want to have the music sheet handy if it's not one that's familiar to you. I will follow my own advice and have my music sheet handy. with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. For you are the source of light and life. You made us in your image and called us to new life in Jesus Christ, our Lord. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. On the night he was handed over to suffering and death, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it, and he gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ has risen. Christ will come again. We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, in this sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Recalling his death, resurrection, and ascension, we offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, the holy food and drink of new and unending life in him. Sanctify us also that we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament, to serve you in unity, constancy, and peace, and at the last day bring us with all your saints into the joy of your eternal kingdom. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ, by him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom.
sweet the feast.
Hallelujah.
The gifts of God for the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. Verses 1 and 4.